I'm delighted to be joined on stage by Mark Kaylor. Mark's a senior market research analyst at Allergan and has been the customer engagement manager for our managed market subscription. And so it'll be great to get Mark's feedback and perspective as we go through the last 5 years and all that we've accomplished together at Allergan. We also wanted to recognize the donation made. In this case, thanks to Mark, the donation was made to Khadija through Kiva. And also thank our track sponsor, Alliance Consulting, for their help with this session.
Alrighty, well, we're gonna jump into the vision here, but to kind of back up where we were at the time when we first were engaged with Model N was we used Model N to show and display our IMS data. We were buying data from IMS, sales, you know, TRXs, units, things of that nature. And we used Model N to see it. But we also had other databases. We buy formulary data, we buy claims and copay data. And so we basically had three different databases. So when someone came to me and said, hey, I want to see the top payers, what our sales are, what the formulary is, and what the copay is, I had to go to three different databases and pull the data and then map them manually in Excel. And it's not that easy because just something simple as WellPoint, it's called WellPoint in one, it's called Anthem WellPoint in something else, it's called BCBS Anthem WellPoint in another one, so you can't do a matching in Excel, you can't even do it alphabetically. So it was a pain in the butt, basically. It was very time consuming, going to three databases, that's a lot of work, mapping it up manually is a lot of work. Also, because of that, we didn't have our brand people and our salespeople, our account managers, really able to pull their own data. So, you know, we said, hey, it was a bottleneck. They were coming to me and a couple other analysts that I have supporting me for information. So if you get a lot of requests, it took a long time to get it done. So what we did is we basically just said, hey, we sat down with Model N and we said, help us come up with a platform, help us come up with a long-term vision. And that's what they did.
Thanks, Mark. You know, thinking through those pain points and challenges, we looked at what type of a vision would make sense, and we identified four themes we thought would help realize answers to some of the challenges and questions that Allergan faced. And so I'll spend only a little time on these in this slide, because the slides coming up, we really sort of flesh out the details for each of these different components. And so starting from the top, and perhaps the most important component we wanted to realize was this one-stop shop concept. And so, you know, folks I think have heard this over the last couple of days. What we really wanted to do was have the account managers and even home office users that Mark mentioned, just like him, be able to go to one place to get their answers as opposed to logging into three different websites, maybe doing some Excel gymnastics to sort of ultimately uncover the insight they wanted. We wanted everyone to come to one place, get the data there. Self-service model. You know, for an application like this to be scalable, we wanted folks like Mark to not be a bottleneck for answers. And so there's only two or three of Marks walking around Allergan. We wanted to create an application, a solution online that actually had resources built in that can help answer most, if not all, of the questions that folks may have on an ongoing basis. If that was able to happen, folks like Mark wouldn't get phone calls all the time with questions, and hopefully will allow for us to do a lot more with the system that we were able to put together. You know, intuitive data representation was a big deal for us because managed markets data can be complex and oftentimes dense. And so we pride ourselves in thinking of creative visualizations to bring to life the insight and the data, and we wanted to make that be a big part of our project here. And finally, while we didn't know all of the questions that we'd get over the 5 years that we've developed the solution at Allergan, we knew we wanted to build a foundation that ultimately would be scalable. And so we didn't want to be in a position that 3 years from, let's say 2009, we'd have to start from scratch to develop something just because we forgot a key requirement or two. And so we wanted to make sure the application or the platform itself was scalable. And so those are the things we considered as our vision as we sort of embarked on this journey. Now, I'm sort of stealing our thunder a little bit by providing a 4 year or 5 year snapshot here. I sort of wanted to ground people on all the accomplishments or milestones along the way that we were able to accomplish collaborating with Allergan and Mark in particular. You know, it's also interesting You know, back in 2009, the year one of this project, we wanted to create this centralized web-based reporting platform, that one-stop shop that people can get used to coming to for all of their answers, sort of, you know, learn to crawl before you walk and run. That was our vision, and we sort of did that. But then year two, three, and four sort of fed off what we did in year one. We kind of were folding features and tools back into our subscription and just kept expanding the feature and functionality of our application. So year two included coverage data integration. This is really where we took complicated data sets and brought that into the platform itself. Year three, we got a little bit strategic for a different set of users of our application, sort of the home office users, and created this dashboard called e-dashboard or executive dashboards. We'll talk about that more as we get to that section. And then finally, once we had all of this data in one place and folks were using these reports, we started getting very strategic and focused with the type of business questions that folks were coming to us with and answers developed for them. And we'll talk about some of the tools that were developed in helping with that. And finally, we want to wrap up with just a brief slide on what's to come. Like I said, I really would look forward or look, really would like if folks can ask questions during these slides itself. But that last section, we'd like it to be very interactive and be a discussion of sorts.
So basically in 2009, kind of going back where we were, we got a lot of business questions asked from us. And I think they were pretty typical business questions. You know, how's my sales doing? How am I comparing my market share versus the national market share? How are the parent, the payer, and the children doing? Kind of just your typical stuff. And so there again, they were all coming to me back then. This was really driven with, you know, we're specifically looking at questions here with IMS data, TRX sales. And so if you kind of boil all those questions up and just, and I was answering them, right, pulling the data and answering them, I said, okay, how can we, went to Model N and said, how can we put all these, this information in a platform so, again, they don't have to go through me. These are standard questions. I'll answer the advanced analytical questions, the complex questions, but how can we take these standard questions, put them in a report so our account management team, so our inside, we call them in managed markets, customer marketing people, and even the brand people, how can they access all this information on their own? If they have a simple question, they shouldn't have to come to me, they should be able to do it. So we posed that question to Model N, and Gulshan's gonna take you into basically what they developed, and now we have those people accessing the tool on their own, which is great.
Thanks, Mark. And if you jump in our time machine and go back 5 years, year one, this is sort of what we developed. It was a homepage, a landing pad of sorts, for account managers, customer marketing folks, and analysts like Mark. You know, we can spend probably a good hour just talking about all the different components on this screen, but what we really wanted to do and make sure of was that this reporting tree on the right-hand side was intuitive, simple, and useful, and sticky. We wanted account managers to start using this to do all of their analytics when it came to their customers, the managed markets organizations. And so to do that, we spoke to Mark, we spoke to some account managers and realized that this reporting structure had to be as simple as possible. I'm getting a little tactical here, but you know, if I walk through what you're looking at, in its simplest form, they would go to the right-hand side of the screen, we blew that up for this graphic, they would find their own title, either you're a CAM or a RAM, they'd expand that. They would find their name, in this case we expanded Doyle, you'd expand that. We then realized that their questions are very specific to the product, a particular product, and so in this case, if Mr. Doyle had a question about Product S, he would expand on Product S, and his accounts would be listed underneath it, and then you'd just click on any one account, and it would load a sort of automated report. It's kind of a PowerPoint-like format that walks you through the critical trends and insights that matter for that particular account. It was just that simple, and we were happy to see that once account managers were given the tool itself and trained on it, which wasn't too much training that was necessary, they found it simple, easy to use, and they were sending stuff to PowerPoint all the time for offline use. They were logging in and using it in the tool itself, and that was a big win for us, I think, right, Mark? Was just to have that usability be so high.
Yeah, we still use this. This tool is pretty old now, and it's not, you know, nowadays everything's dashboards and more interactive, which we developed that, and we'll get into that in a bit. But this tool, even though we developed it a few years ago, every year we sit down with the CAMs, the corporate account managers, the regional account managers, the RAMs, and we go through it with a power user group, and we go slide by slide, and we say, is this filling your data needs? And so we'll make little tweaks to it. We don't want to tweak it every month, but once a year we sit down, and they still love this tool. I'd rather have somebody download 40 slides and delete 35 of them and just use 5 slides than to have to create a slide. That's going to take them an hour, where deleting a slide is point and click. So the tool is still used a lot today.
And you know, from a data perspective, what do we include day one? And I bring that up because as we go forward in our journey, we're going to reference how certain things have changed over time. But year one, it really was getting the syndicated data in there, the prescription level data, unit level data. We had benchmarking to nation or channel, depending on your question. We also had channel breakouts, you know, be it Part D specific questions or commercial or Medicaid. Things of that nature was what we wanted to just automate and have be available to folks day one. When you actually load a report itself, you know, we touched on how one of the themes we thought from a vision perspective that would ensure success for us was intuitive data representation. We realized that folks out there have different ways of interpreting data. Some people like list views, like the top graphic. Others like more of a sort of a visual graphic, such as a tree map at the bottom. Ultimately, they both try to say the same story. You know, in this case, you've got accounts for Coventry Health as an example, plans specifically, and then you've got performance metrics for these plans to see, you know, is there an outlier, trend break you really want to zone in on or focus on? If you had a list view, it's interactive. You could sort any of the column headers to get the biggest declining plan or the biggest gaining plan, rather. You can filter on a plan in particular if you just wanted to look for a unique plan. On the other hand, you've got a graphic like the tree map at the bottom where it's very sort of, you know, color oriented. And for folks who may not be as familiar with a tree map, the way you read this is, you know, it's biggest to smallest in terms of accounts from top left to bottom right. The size of each square usually represents market volume or potential. The color is a performance metric. And so if you look at the legend at the bottom, red is bad, green is good, and you've got shades in between. And so, right, for someone looking at the tree map, very quickly they can see the second biggest plan, the Adventure Coventry account in California, is your second biggest plan in a shade of red. And that might make you either drill in or look at a specific separate report on that particular plan to see what's going on. We wanted to make that intuitive data representation help with insights and trend tracking. You know, the last topic for year one that we wanted to accomplish was give folks like Mark and his extended analyst team with a tool they can use for ad hoc analytics. And so, you know, while we supported about 80 to 90% of the business questions with the pre-digested reports that were pre-canned, ready on the reporting tree, we knew that on a weekly, monthly basis, inevitably there'd be questions that come up with a very short turnaround time that folks would need to jump on and get an answer or a PowerPoint deck ready for. And so to help with requests like that, we give access to a tool, we call it AIM Labs at Allergan, where folks like Mark and even we at times log in to sort of put ad hoc analytics together. You know, the powerful thing about this is, you know, you start off with the PowerPoint mentality. First question it asks you for is, what type of a graphic would you like? A line chart, a bar chart, tree map like we saw earlier. You pick that, and then you've got options you can use to configure the graphic. And so, you know, which products would you like to see? Would you like to see volume, share, productivity? What would you like to see as your measure? And then finally, do you want to break that out by anything? Do you want to look at, you know, targeted physicians versus not, or certain specific payers, perhaps? You've got filtering capabilities. So let's say, you know, Mark's manager came to Mark and said, hey, you know, in a couple of days, we need to do an analysis specific to the North region. Can you put 6 or 7 slides together to what really matters most from a managed markets perspective for the North region? Mark would jump in here, go to filters, change the global filter to the North region, and the next set of slides that he develops would all be specific to just that. Once you're done authoring the deck, and Mark does this quite a bit, he saves it, and in the back end, our data and processing people actually update the deck on a monthly basis with the latest data that's available. So as IMS sends us data in real time, Mark doesn't have to go in each month and recreate his slides. His deck just gets moved forward to the latest data set available. And so it helps if 3 months from now that same question came up, Mark would just go back to his analysis and send it to PowerPoint. It'd be that easy. Any questions about what we've touched on so far? Any comments? Okay, plug away.
So then the next year, in 2010, we built this system, right? We have all of our IMS data, all of our sales data in there. And again, I touched on it earlier, we also spent a lot of time and energy matching up the IMS, the sales data, with formulary data. What's our tier status? Same questions were coming in. What's my copay at the payer level, the plan level, the channel level, all that sort of stuff? So those are all the business questions that are coming in. Again, at that time, it was a manual process going to 3 databases, trying to match them up in Excel. So next logical thing was to say, hey, let's go to Model N, take those 3 disparate data feeds, map them together, put them all into 1 database. So that's the question we posed to them. And they did a great job. And we'll dig into what that integrated system looks like.
You know, before we jump into what that integrated system looks like, we need to spend a little bit of time understanding the complexity behind this type of an exercise. I think for most of the folks in the audience, this may actually be things you've heard of or seen internally. But this actually was a fairly time-consuming exercise, and even worse, it's very unsexy. You know, I think people don't want to talk about the data integration. They'd rather just jump ahead to what you can do with the integrated data. However, if you don't have this process nailed down and actually as well as you can, the insights that come out on the other side perhaps are not as reliable or as accurate. And so I just wanted to spend a minute on some of the challenges that we faced looking at bridging these different vendor data feeds together. And so, you know, starting from the top, peer and plan relationships are in constant flux. There need to be business rules and logic in place to help manage that. You've got mergers and acquisitions that get realized at different times in different data sets. And so how do you sync all those time frames together so that the end user, Mark and his core audiences at Allergan, don't have to sort of ask those questions as to, hey, has this merger been registered in the IMS data versus WK versus the coverage database? It's all synced together. The naming convention, and Mark touched on the WellPoint example, can be very different in different databases. So you really do need the right logic to bring them together. Probably the most complicated reason why this is challenging is the many-to-many mapping. And so just taking an example of an IMS plan perhaps being bridged to a coverage benefit design, you oftentimes see a many-to-many mapping, meaning many benefit designs actually map in a sort of funky way to many plans. So you actually need algorithms in place to break ties and actually allocate the right relationships. You know, the graphic on the right looks pretty cool and actually is a real example of what one such many-to-many mapping can look like. And so this really is complex stuff that we had to actually rope in our advanced analytics group to help understand and develop an algorithm for. Well, when you get past all of this unsexy work, you can get to what we like to think of as more of the sexy outcomes of some of these data integrations. And so, you know, It's silly, but you know, of one screen example, like what you're looking at on the projector here, is ultimately what we wanted to realize. And so imagine having a list of this type where your rows are your pairs, your top pairs, that's sorted on market volume, let's say. But your columns now are a blend of multiple data sets. And so you've got your sales syndicated data up there, your market volume, your product volume, perhaps product share and share change metrics. So that's one set of metrics. Right next to that, you can now see your product's tier status, lives information, as well as your competitor's tier status. And then finally, what are the drugs cost to the patients? And so you can see the claims level data of the average approved copay for not just your product, but also your competition. Very quickly, in one simple snapshot like this, I would argue that account managers could answer 6 or 7 of their 10 questions they would have any given day. You look at an account, you see how well they're doing. You may ask, well, I wonder if we're disadvantaged in this pair, so the tier status would help with that. And then finally, let's say you're at parity. You both happen to be preferred, which happens quite a bit in certain therapeutic classes. Is there a cost disadvantage for us in an account, and that average copay information would help answer that question. Again, all in one screen, easily available, and that really was the meat of what we accomplished in 2010.
So that was a big deal. Getting all that stuff together, like Olshan just said, I mean, taking three databases and putting it into one, then you're like, okay, now we can really take all this information. I mean, that slide there wasn't very sexy, it was very powerful, but then how do we take it to the next level? You know, we had things earlier, the tree map that was color-coded and it showed exceptions, right? You're doing well, you're red, you're not doing well. So how can we now get a little more flashier and do dashboards and take all this information, take our sales, take our claims, take our copay data, mush it all together, show it in charts and graphs, and be able to answer questions at a very top line level and a very specific level. All users could use it, make it super easy to use. Within two or three clicks, they can drill down at any level and see all of this integrated data. Now it's the fun part. Let's make some tools with this sort of stuff. Instead of just spreadsheets, how can we take it to the next level in terms of dashboards, charts, and graphs and that? So again, we posed that question to Model N and said, hey, what could we develop that we can do that with? And then this is what they came up with.
Yeah, this was a starting point for us as we develop, you know, the data's done. Now we move to action and tools and dashboards that help with the, you know, with the visualization and insight tracking. You know, e-dashboard was the first on the list. E-dashboard stands for executive dashboards. What we also realized over the first few years was, while we were satisfying, and I think making folks on the field side, account managers and home office users happy with the dashboards and reports we had at the time, we also wanted to expand the audiences that can benefit from a tool like this. And so there were these customer marketing folks that had MBOs. They were tracking managed markets insights, but they had specific ones they really wanted to track on an ongoing basis. You know, it's almost like they wanted their stock ticker. How am I doing on certain insights and metrics that I can monitor on an ongoing basis? And so we wanted to put together a starting point for these folks where it would almost be an iGoogle-like homepage where they could log in, see these metrics. You know, if they were interested in drilling into anything in particular, they could do that, but at least it would put everything in one page, four or five key graphics, and they wouldn't be digging through 30 slides like the account managers were to get at the insights. Now, you know, not to pat ourselves on the back, but I thought we had a pretty good starting point as to what that could look like for the customer marketing team. But, you know, in the interest of just validation, we actually connected and did interviews with about 8 to 10 folks, sat them down, talked to them about what they really care about looking at from a data perspective, digested all that feedback, and as luck would have it, what they really wanted to see was very close to our starting point. There was some feedback we incorporated to tweak it a little bit, but at the end of the day, you know, the e-dashboard concept we realized was exactly what they wanted to track on an ongoing basis. It's a little hard to see, I'm sure, from the back of the room here, but you know, I'll spend a little bit of time describing what you guys are looking at on the screen in terms of the different components. The graphics themselves can be customized. It actually was custom to different users. Some folks really cared about a particular product or therapeutic category, others a different one, and so we really had to tweak it as necessary. But you know, in a nutshell, if you look at the top left-hand corner, just like we did with the reporting tree earlier, your product selection was your first branch off point. And so you picked product as an example to what you wanted to see your reports for. Once you did that, we actually had multiple reports embedded within product S. You may be interested in looking at your volume and share metrics, perhaps your payer dynamics, formulary copay, or profitability P&L type of analytics. And so depending on your question of interest, you'd pick one of those reports. And once you selected that, The graphics on the right or the screenshots on the right would update based on your selection. You had filters and other options on the left as well. So let's say you globally cared about a particular payer. You could actually type the name of the payer, Aetna as an example perhaps, and you'd find it, you'd select that as the filter, and again, all your graphics on the right would update to just show you the insights for Aetna. On the right, you know, we sort of had 4 to 5 graphics take over the screen. Interestingly, while they might look small on the screen, each of them on the top right-hand corner had an expand button, so you really could expand and blow it up to take over the whole screen if you really wanted to look at the inside. Some of these graphics, like the tree map, and if you did scroll down on this window, there was a list view at the bottom as well, were very interactive. In that, let's say as you were tracking your MBOs, a particular pair stood out to you. Aetna happened to be dropping share for your product by 5%. That's a surprise because the rest of the nation's relatively flat for your product. Why is this the case? We actually have this concept called drill down, where you could click on that account and it actually gives you a menu of options where you could open up a pop-up window with 5 to 6 slides that describe just the account you drilled into. And that was our way of saying, you know, on the surface, you only have 5 or 6 graphics, maybe most days or weeks, that gives you the answers you need. Only when you have a follow-up question, you find an outlier, is when you can drill in and get additional insights or graphics. You don't have to sort of be, you know, inundated with that type of data up front. It sort of is a selection choice.
You know, and a really cool thing what we did with this also was, for us, formulary change, right? And anybody in managed markets, a formulary, a win or a loss, is a big deal. So every time we say we went from a covered brand to a preferred brand, we capture that change. The first question they would come to me and say, hey, can you show me by territory, can you show me by doctor, if we got a win at Aetna, where is that? It's a national account, but we know they have regional strengths. So what doctor list should we run out and say, hey, these, you know, what top 20 doctors are using Aetna, could we run out and tell them about this win? So one of the things in there was a formulary change box. It was like that lower right one there. You clicked on it, and like Goldstein was saying, 5 slides popped open. One of those things that was automated was the doc list and a territory list that showed where their sales were by doctor and by territory. So I didn't have to go do that every time. It was one of those things, if it's a reoccurring request, automate it. It's that simple. And then they can go do it themselves. They don't even have to ask me. They have that answer within 2 minutes.
Yep. Thanks, Mark.
So then going into 2012, just last year, it's great. Again, we have all of our integrated data. Where now we made this e-dashboard tool where we can see and do all these cool things. We also had other questions that were coming up that were complex questions. We were using the system to answer them, right? Things like, you know, how will my contracting decisions, how will coverage change? And can I do role playing, scenario playing? If I get a win at this account, how will it affect coverage across territories? We were doing that. It was just super time consuming. Sometimes we would even actually have Model N folks do it. But it would take us a day or two to do that. Another big question that came up was, how can we look at performance with our contracting? So again, we took these questions that we were answering, again, on kind of ad hoc. You know, I'd get that question like, oh, you know, that's 2 days worth of work to do that, to use the system. How can we automate it? So what we did is we actually came up with a couple of cool tools to answer these more complex questions. And we're going to dive into those tools.
Yeah, I think folks in the audience, I hope, are also getting the sense that, you know, 2009, let's go back to that for a second, you know, our goal was broad. You know, develop a platform, you know, get the basic reporting on there, get folks to use it. As the years go on, the focus narrows and becomes more pointed, right? And so in this case, by the time we get to last year, people are used to getting the data a certain way. They're used to the insights, they're used to the data integration. It's almost as though their business questions evolve. It becomes more sophisticated. We actually can do more now. It becomes far more strategic and insightful. I mean, you need to go through the journey to get to that point. But once you're there, we can actually answer these really, I call them fun questions. They're more strategic around, you know, if I had to go after the next contract, which one should I go after? What type of an impact would that have nationally or across all my sales territories? Once I sign the contract, how do I measure the post-program analytics around it? And those were some of the questions we tackled last year. You know, we're going to jump into a demo of this actually right now in real time. Hopefully everything works out okay. But to set the table a little bit, you know, the first tool we wanted to talk about was this coverage projection tool. Idea, again, was marketing and managed markets were working together. And I think this happens in all pharma companies, usually in the summer or fall timeframe, as you're looking at contract negotiations and extensions for the next year. You have the question around, okay, if Aetna wants us to make a contract bid for them, what's the impact a win in Aetna would have nationally to my coverage number, percentage of lives that are covered, as well as subnationally? Inevitably, while Aetna, as Mark mentioned, is a national account, there'll be certain pockets of the country that'll benefit more than others. You wanna know that ahead of time so you can resource the team, the sales team, appropriately to take advantage of this new catalyst you're about to see. Conversely, if you have a loss coming up, you want to defend that business as quickly as possible before the change happens. And so a tool like this helps us sort of prepare for that, and marketing and managed markets can collaborate to take advantage of this. And so I'll jump in on my computer if we could switch the video screen to actually show you guys what it looks like.
Yeah, one of the things that, while he's loading this up, is we would get things, our RAMs, regional account managers, are working right with their sales counterparts. And especially for us, it was eye care. We do a lot of glaucoma drugs and things like that. And the West region was not doing real well. So the sales team and the managed markets team got together and we said, okay, what can we do to drive sales in the West region? So we looked at all sorts of metrics and things like that, but one of them was, hey, for this particular drug, it was a relatively new allergy drug, we didn't have very good coverage. So how do we increase coverage in the West region? So we were polling, you know, my first question was, well, okay, do the sales have a legitimate gripe? How is their coverage compared to the nation? Are they indexed worse to the nation and they're just griping, or you know, they have a legitimate gripe, or are they the same as the nation and it's like, well, they're just yelling louder? So we were doing these analysis actually, again, using the system, but it was very manual. It would take me quite a bit of time and other folks quite a bit of time to do it. So again, what we said is, hey, this is, and then as soon as you did it once, everyone goes, that's great. Hey, you could do it at the region level. Can you do it at the territory level? Can you do it from my territory? And you're just, you know, well, it takes a long time to do it, so, you know, I'm selfish. No, I didn't want to do it, but so let's automate it. So this is the actual live tool that we have here, and it's really cool. We'll get into it because it does take a couple seconds for it to update. And if you notice that the way we're broken out, our sales group for eye care is we obviously have a national level, but we go by region. We have five regions, areas. Most people call them districts. We call them area managers. Most people call them district managers. We have, I think it was 21, 22 districts, and then we have 99 territories. So we developed this tool so we could look at it. We could slice it any way you want. If I'm talking to a director, they want to see the director level. If I'm talking to an area manager, they want to see the area. They also got to eventually drill it down to the territory. So the tool's pretty cool in the sense of we can look at data any way we want to. So that's what you're seeing in the columns on the left there. It goes region, area, territory. So we have it filtered by the lowest level at this point. And this is one sheet for one brand. So you can do things, and again, it was really developed for scenario analysis. If this happens, what's the outcome? But the cool part about it is you can actually, even before you run a scenario, you can just look at what is the current situation of this brand. So all the data in there, we broke apart our coverage, all the buckets. We have preferred, preferred with a step edit, covered, covered with a step edit, not covered. We have all these different buckets. And you'll see within each bucket going across there, you have the current, a scenario, and the delta. Well, obviously we haven't ran a scenario yet, so the current and the scenario look the same and the delta is all zero. But you can even look at it and just say, okay, you answer the question, I can say, Gulshan, I'm looking at all my territories. Which territory has the best preferred coverage, the most lives in preferred coverage, most TRXs in preferred coverage in the commercial channel?
And so, as Mark mentioned, the tab we're already in the commercial output. Somebody would just go to the current coverage number. And in this case, we want to sort from largest to smallest. And what you'll see is Nashville, Tennessee has the highest coverage for this brand in this output.
And the nation line's frozen right above it. So you can see everybody, how they compare to the nation. So right away, I know, OK, which territory for this brand in the commercial channel, which one's indexed the highest? So you could ask another question. You could say, okay, let's switch over to part D and let's look at areas instead of territories. Let's look at areas. Which area has the most scripts going through? Which area has the most non-covered?
And so I just switched from territory to areas in the drop-down box up top. And so, you know, I'm actually going off the projected screen over there and I just realized I should have had my glasses on, so bear with me. And so we talked about not covered. Here we go. And just like I did on the commercial tab, we'll go to the current section and look for the highest not covered proportion of volume. And when you do that, you see that Puerto Rico and San Francisco, the territories, those two territories, have a disproportionately high not covered volume relative to the nation.
Yep. So again, if a salesperson says, hey, I'm disadvantaged, help me, you could look to see, are they truly disadvantaged? Where does Dallas as an area, because we're going to drill down next with Dallas. Where does Dallas stand?
So, you know, I'll go, so we have to go back here to territories.
No, as an area, Dallas is right there.
Oh, the area of Dallas, got it. So if you go halfway down, is that, that's Dallas right there. And so I'm going to look across to say what the statistics for Dallas look like.
Just make sure when you ask Model N people questions, they have their glasses on so you get good answers.
There we go, slowly but surely.
Yep.
And so if you look at the preferred volume in Dallas, Mark, actually, let me ask you to read that for me,
sir. So basically, they have their index, they're at 27. They're basically right with the nation. So the next question then is, let's actually run a scenario. This is what the tool is built for. So it's pretty cool. It tells you where you are now. So if we go to the scenario tab and say, OK, we're going to move Aetna, Part D. We're not covered right now. We're going to go become a preferred brand. We know we won that contract. What's that mean? We know, you know, Aetna's a national account. They have regional strength. Where's that going? So he goes to the input tab, and we have a column for all of our commercial payers. We have a column for all of our Part D payers. And then he changes it. It says right there it's not covered, and he's changing it to preferred. And then he's got to hit run. It's actually a lot of data in the background. That's why it took so long to build this tool manually. Now that it's automated, but even then, you see the processors, it takes, you know, maybe 20 to 30 seconds, depending on how fast your computer is, to crunch this. So while it's crunching it, one of the things that's pretty cool is the output tabs. If you look across the bottom there, we can just isolate it. The first thing we do at Allergan is we always look at, when we talk Aetna, the first question is Aetna Commercial or Aetna Part D? United Commercial, United Part D. So we always do our first slice by channel. So you can see across the bottom, we have a commercial output, we have a Part D output, we also have a fee-for-service, FSS Medicaid, fee-for-service Medicaid output. So on the inputs, we can change any commercial plan, we can change any Part D plan, we can change any state Medicaid, and then see the outcome just in that channel. And then on the far right, it's hidden in there, we have a total outcome, a total channel roll-up. So I could look at a territory, region, area, and say, for Part D, what changed? But then also, not just in the Part D universe, but what did their total universe change? So it's nice to have that entire roll-up going on in there as well. Is it done?
OK, I think we're good to go. And so once the scenario is run, you save the change. It takes a few seconds. You can actually go back to the output tab, and all of a sudden, you now start seeing values in the delta section. Your current coverage will now be different than the scenario because you've actually run a scenario. And so in this case, we have this delta column showing you the increase in preferred because, as you may remember, we took Aetna Part D from not covered to preferred. And so if you wanted to see, given this win, who would benefit the most, you would just sort on the delta, largest to smallest. And as you can see, Dallas is at the top of the list. They stand to benefit about 9 percentage points of coverage, a bump up, if in fact Aetna was to be a win for them.
Yep.
Interestingly, nationally, you're only up 2.3 percentage points, right? So it's more subtle. Dallas really does benefit so much more than the nation does.
Yep. So it's just a great, so now when you get a win, obviously, what we do is we communicate our wins. You know, if they're national accounts, we communicate them to the nation. But if it's Blue Shield of California, it's going to go to the California team. Florida doesn't need to know about it. But again, Aetna, okay, we're going to probably communicate that win to everybody. But we can go in here real quick and say, all right, Dallas, this is a national win. You guys really need to drive this contract home. You have the most gain out of this, so there's, you know, no reason why the area manager and the reps in Dallas aren't out there really pushing the Aetna extra hard.
You know, continue to spend another minute on this, we just ran one scenario with one payer change going from not covered to covered. But as folks in the home office plan, and let's imagine in the summer or fall time from you doing these what-if scenarios to identify the accounts you want to go after for a win or a loss, perhaps by November or December, everything is baked. You've heard back from the payers in terms of what your tier status will be going forward. And you notice there's about 6 to 7 changes that are going to come up. This can be a very powerful tool to actually run multiple changes as one scenario. So for example, if Aetna was a win, but Humana was a loss, and Coventry was a loss, and BCBS WellPlan was also a win, you make all those changes, save them, go to the output tab, which actually can also be an all-channel output tab, and all of a sudden you have a blueprint to share with the sales team and the marketing team that includes all of the changes in concert, so you truly can see who stands to benefit net-net at the end of all these changes. It really can be powerful.
Yeah, because instead of just lives, like I could add up the lives and say, okay, we won 1 million lives, we lost 500,000 lives, lost 100,000 lives, won 200, you know, you can just do the simple math on the lives, but this is actually TRXs by geography. So, because, you know, life isn't necessarily a life depending on the plan, if it's a high control, low control. So to Gulshan's point, you could at the, you know, when you're coming into Part D renewals, right, you're in that October, November timeframe, and you start knowing your contracts for next year. Hey, here's my wins, here's my losses, plug this in there. I can spit out and say, I know now what my new coverage is gonna be nationally, and, you know, Salesforce-wise, we can start targeting, covering our losses and going after our wins.
Yep, resource allocation can be a big deal. So for example, if you see a particular pocket of the country that all of a sudden will be very disadvantaged and you have a coupon or a voucher program out there, you may want to start flooding that geography with those coupons to offset what seems to be a price differential that'll be forming as the year kicks off.
Yeah, I forgot about that. It's a great point. We get a lot of questions too on, hey, the brand team just printed 10,000 coupons, right? You got to have a coupon for those situations where you're not covered. But coupon allocations, we print 10,000, we have five regions, each region gets 2,000. You know, it's that simple. And then that region manager counts how many area managers and they give it to them. That area manager then just divides that number with his pot into his territories. I mean, you can do that, but that's not really very good. What you can do is you could say, okay, where are we not covered, or where do we have a high copay or something like that? You could look at it, use this model and spit it out by territory. So just the top territory should get your coupon cards. Why send a coupon card to a territory that has good coverage? You know, we use this tool, and I worked with one of the region directors, and I said, give all your cards to Chicago. We did this analysis. It was Chicago. It basically boiled down to Chicago was the most disadvantaged. I go, take your cards, your thousands of cards, give them to the Chicago area manager, and go flood that. Your other areas in Milwaukee or other surrounding areas, Ohio, you're fine. And we could never do that again. It would just be the simple math. It was kind of a dumb way of using your cards, but this way you can allocate even your cards and make sure your card ROI gets better as well.
Terrific. You know, if we could switch back to the PowerPoint, and I also realized, you know, not surprising to you and I, we're running short on time, since okay. We are fairly talkative. So, you know, we're gonna buzz through the other slides. We can always ask questions. Actually, is there a question in the audience?
Is there a question in the audience?
I saw the mic, I wasn't sure. You know, we'll keep going, but if folks have questions, please do jump in. So that's the coverage projection tool. That was the output we just walked through. Another sort of powerful tool we looked at this last year was what we call an EPTI, Executive Pull-Through Index dashboard. And so this was the first time we actually married contracting data with performance or sales data. The question really was for key accounts, about 10 of them in particular, where the majority of the rebate dollars were being spent, they wanted to put together a dashboard that looked at the actual financial performance married to the syndicated data performance, the share growth or lack thereof. Now, we had to work very closely with the finance department to get some of these metrics. We had the IMS data as an example, and we bridged the two together in the form of this dashboard. Just, and this is all dummy data, but looking just quickly at this screenshot, what you have is a drop-down box at the top where you can pick the account of interest. If you want a very micro analysis, you may want to specifically focus on a particular contract, let's say WellPoint Commercial in this case. However, we also have a bubbled up or aggregate view, and so it's called all contracts. If you want a macro view and want to see everything in concert for a big meeting coming up, you could just pick that and all your financial numbers would all be bubbled up. On the left-hand side, you have a large number of selections. Why do we have all these? We soon realized after developing the first version of this that we had multiple audiences, and finance may have certain metrics they wanted to focus on, while customer marketing had others. We didn't want to prevent or constrain the dashboard to just show a few, so we just gave folks the ability to toggle things on or off depending on the business question or the audience that was using it. So you can actually turn things on and off over here as you do your graphic changes, which has a dual y-axis. The left axis includes rebate percentages or share numbers. The right one includes financial metrics. Very quickly, you can actually start comparing things that are actual to goal. And so if your goal is X, very quickly you can see, are your actuals measuring up? If they are or they're not, either case, since the financial data oftentimes lags by about 6 odd months, the syndicated data can be very powerful in sort of acting as a bellwether. And so if you, in fact, are missing your actuals, you may want to look at the share trajectory to see, are you seeing an increase in share coming up? If you are, there's some hope that the financial numbers will also bump up and that gap might be bridged. However, and in this example, we notice that the dark green line, the actual share, actually is relatively flat. And since the actual financial numbers, the brown triangles, were below consistently the goal set, the purple X marks, there was no reason to believe that this bridge would be gapped, or this gap would be bridged, rather. And so we knew that, you know, we had to prepare a story as to why this may be the case. This indicated data gave us a heads up on what's to come.
Yeah, we can skip the MMG.
Yes, sure. MMG was just a tool we developed for account managers to work with reps, gives you the top 20 accounts and some coverage information about them.
I can kind of see the audience here. Who has a database that has sales data, formulary data, and claims and copay data kind of all in one database, all mapped together? Is anybody? Most of the folks that have that, is it separate? You're looking at separate databases? Yeah. Because that's what really brought the value together, was just getting them all together, as we talked about earlier. Once we had all that data mapped together, it then opened the door for all these other tools and business ideas. You know, basically you get bombarded with questions. If you get the same question over and over again, how do we automate it? How do we, you know, make a tool then that can answer that question? That's then therefore, and the other thing is to make it super easy to use. Our account managers, not to be mean, I'm not the smartest guy in the world too. We have people that can, let's face it, barely use Excel. And then you have, you know, I know some of the account managers, they have, you know, masters in computer science. But in everything in between, so, you know, we're clicking on their name. We're really making it super easy to use a lot of data for all varied levels of experience out there in terms of computer use.
Mark and Gulshan, we have a question.
Sure.
No, I was just going to comment on the whole, like, you had it on the slide before, like, the challenges of kind of bringing all this data together and, like, the different algorithms that you guys, or at least we've worked on, like, you know, how do you, like, map if you get a mail order script? Mm-hmm. Like, how do you actually associate it with a prescriber?
Yeah, our databases that we're buying IMS for the TRX. We use MMIT for formulary. And I still call them Wolters Kluwer, so Source Healthcare, for claims and copay. So what we do, though, so, and they each have their own naming convention. We name everything back to IMS. So IMS does have a mail order bucket, right? The data comes in and they camouflage the payer, they camouflage the plan. So in that instance, next to that, we're gonna have a formulary unknown, copay unknown. That would be, there's certain buckets that we can't map to, and mail order would be one of them. You can do, there's like PBM unspecified. What we can do, though, is at first we mapped all those unknown and formulary, but we do know what the primary, you know, national formulary is for each PBM, so we put that in there. Now, the child may be different. They can always, you know, run a custom formulary. But there's always, we had to come up with those kind of rules. That's a great question. There's mail order and other kind of odd buckets that are a mishmash of different things, so you can't really give that a formulary status.